Experts say that we have until 2030 to avoid catastrophe.
We went from 4.5 to 8.5 million people needing food aid in just the last 2 months.
And we've seen a nationwide surge in the coronavirus. New cases and hospitalizations are up in more than 40 states.
Good evening, and we begin tonight with the monster hurricane and its deadly impact already.
This really does look like hell on earth.
May not have, like I said, ice in 20 years. May not have winter. I don't think the world's going to maybe burn up, but I hope not. Sorry, Ian. I'm trying to be honest, and I'm trying to
think
about...
Where the hell am I supposed to go with that one, Will?
Where are we supposed to go with that? Globalization has led the human race to live more comfortably right now than at any time throughout our history. Lifespan. Literacy, food availability, almost every metric is better right now. So why don't we feel like it? I've spent the last 10 years in Nome, Alaska, where I found some potential insights by observing modern-day hunter-gatherers or subsistence practitioners. My interviewees are representing themselves. As with any new topic, a good place to start is with definitions. What is your definition of subsistence?
My definition of subsistence? It's in us. It's put in us through our parents and grandparents, and it's a way of life.
It's living off the land. One of the last places in the world, I think, in America, where this is an opportunity for people to do that.
To me, it's my way of life. I don't really eat too much Western food. My family's diet is moose, seal, muck duck, beluga, just a lot of native foods, dry fish, fish.
To me, it's not a practice, it's way of life. I'm the first generation that did not live in a sod home. Just something way deep inside that really nourishes me.
And that is at the heart of it. Doctors and lawyers practice, but Mary and others brought up the fact that subsistence isn't a practice, it's a way of life.
Ultimately, to me, it means family. Family coming together. Most any subsistence activity is almost always family-oriented.
Subsistence has kind of like, almost like a carnal, visceral kind of feel to it. It's like it's a connectedness to the land. It's using your resources. It's being part of your environment.
Subsistence means more than food sourcing. However, the state of Alaska has given approximate economic values of the subsistence harvest in Alaska. Of the total Alaskan harvest of 3.8 billion pounds of wild fish and game, 98.6% is a commercial seafood harvest. Of the remaining 1.4%, almost 1% is a subsistence harvest and is worth close to $500 million of healthy, non-GMO protein. But remember, it's more than food. It's easy to compartmentalize the math of economics and culture to the arts until we think that culture is either economic choices or dance festivals. The truth is, if we only view culture through economics or the arts, we miss the meaning and purpose that many cultural traditions have.
What's the difference when you have enough subsistence cash and when you have enough money in the bank account?
Well, subsistence is we don't consider it, we don't even think about how much do we have enough, do we have enough, do we get enough.
Like if the resource is strong and it's not getting wasted, you catch as many as you can.
American society is a society of more. Since the subsistence harvest isn't the same as money, how do you know when you have enough? How do any of us know when we have enough? It's also important to note here that putting a number to it is like quantifying the importance of the moon.
For one family, one ugruk or bearded seal might be enough. Another families, they might have numerous families that they're trying to provide for. Three, four, five might be the limit. It's the same thing with walrus. It's the same thing with fish.
I honestly don't know. I guess if I look in my freezer and I'm starting to run out, then I know if I have a certain amount of food in my freezer, that's enough. A lot of my hunting trips, my first hunting trips, are for me and my crew. But if we go out anymore, we give a lot of what we catch away.
In subsistence, the harvest is wild game, sea creatures, or plants and roots. To learn best practices for going out into the ocean to harvest a whale, or ways to process and dry salmon in July that you can enjoy in January, you do it with people who have done it. Gratitude and respect are natural byproducts of this education.
There was another important thing in my learning a subsistence way of life was you really have to respect the animal. Stressing it to my boys, you just don't go out and you just, we're going to go out and hunt moose, we're going to go out and hunt caribou, we're going to go get them. It's not that. You know, it's given to you. There was this one elder here in Nome that was, when I got a moose, and she said, "Did you thank the moose for sacrificing its life?" I said, "Yes, I did." "Did you also thank the moose's parents and the moose's grandparents?" I said, "No." "Well, you got to do that." I said, "Wow." So it was deeper than that.
Abundance gives way to sharing, which leads to gratitude for the resource itself. When is the last time we thanked the cow's grandparents for their sacrifice for the hamburger we ate?
And I was pretty much born and raised on a farm. So I learned early on, you know, what food was, how it was produced, where it came from. Nowadays, I feel like there's a really big disconnect between the human race and where our food comes from. And, you know, that's something that's very important for my wife and I to instill into our children to, hey, you know, that came from somewhere. Someone grew that. Someone killed that. Someone harvested that. It didn't just show up at AC in a box.
Got on St. Lawrence Island, if you get more than a couple whales out there, you know, you're dealing with 40 tons. So it's, you know, for a small community with a couple hundred people, and, you know, how many are physically able to do the work, it can be quite burdensome. So you have to be careful that, you know, you don't waste the resources there. It's given to you. So.
We call it dunusak, gift. Share that.
A gift. This becomes a spiritual principle here. It isn't simply economics, it's about gratitude. We show gratitude for gifts, and it helps us to understand our relationship to everything.
I had taken my nephew, Brendan, and my niece, Rhonda, Sharon's daughter, and my son, my oldest son, Josh, glass calm water. And we were like 25 miles from Nome. We were out hunting and he got his first seal. It was a huge pan. I went around the pan and looked underneath if there's any ice below it, because, you know, those are pretty dangerous if there's ice below it. And I said, "Well, you're going to learn how to butcher. I'll show you how to guide you and which way to cut and how to cut and all that." And I stopped and, "Is there a boat around?" And my nephew and niece, "No." He was just glass calm and decided not to put the boat on the ice. He said, "Let's just stretch the anchor out." And we did that, and then it moved again. And a huge chunk of solid, thick ice just popped up between the boat and where we were on the ice. And it just instantly pushed it out as we were trying to pull the boat. But the current and the ice, that huge chunk of ice just kept pushing it out. And the pan started coming up. There was me at the bottom, my nephew, Rhonda, and my son. And I told Brendan, "I'm not letting go of the anchor. I'm just going to hold on to it." And I was holding on to it like this with the knife in my right hand. And I felt something sharp. I knew I'd cut myself. And I just kept holding on. I was trying to pull the anchor. And that ice kept on coming up and coming up. You know, it was like more than a 45-degree angle. And then next thing I knew, I was in the water. Then I let go of the anchor and it got my boot and started putting me down too. So I kicked and I kicked and I kicked. And then finally it got off and I started coming up. As soon as I put my arms out and came up like this, and my legs just cramped up instantly. And I couldn't tread, and I was using my arms. And my nephew, Brendan, he didn't hesitate. He just dove in the water. As soon as he hit the water, I don't remember anything. Woke up, I was on the ice, and Josh was on the very top, and Rhonda. And so, well, one of you guys going to have to swim for the boat. And by then, it was drifting away. It's got to be Brendan, you know. He went to the bow, pulled the anchor line, started the motor. Everybody got on. They put my PFD suit on. They duct taped my fingers. I had two fingers cut. So we started heading back, and then we got like 15, 12 miles, and I saw a bunch of seals on the ice. Let's at least get one more. They both turned around. No, we're going home.
Mary is an expert at gathering edible plants and roots, and here shares a story of how to practice sustainable harvesting. These types of stories lead to a body of knowledge passed down from hunt to hunt, season to season, millennia to millennia.
Another thing I want to cover is when I dig for roots, what we call Eskimo potatoes. Interior people call it Indian potatoes. It's mazu. It's very woody in the summertime, but in spring and fall, it's very edible. It's very sweet root. And you dig it up, and I chop off the top, and then I replant it, put the top back into the ground, and in 2 years, there'll be another huge root that you can dig up again.
Investing in the future wild harvest takes commitment to the resource and to each other. It's difficult and dangerous to live the subsistence lifestyle. You'd think it would lead one to want to hoard the product of that risk, but it's actually the opposite. Whereas in the money economy, there is never enough, in the subsistence economy, because you have a relationship with a resource, your excess has a built-in mechanism for connections with each other, because you share it.
The real spiritual aspect of it was get 200 or 300 chum, and I'd load up the back of the truck with snow, and then I'd go and give them to people. And then when I started crabbing, I did the same. And what?
How do you feel about the animals you're hunting?
I respect them a lot. I try not to do anything to disrespect them. If I'm not hunting them, I leave them alone.
I try to provide for my sisters, so, and my brothers. If they don't get a moose, then I, like I said, I try to share what I got. Hopefully it'll come back and I'll get more, which seems to work, so.
When I have extra, I just share with like the seniors that live in the hospital. Drop off goodies for them, some with some seal oil, so they could enjoy.
Yeah, just harvesting moose and caribou, and you know, delivering to elders in town, especially those from the island. We would deliver. And I always made it a point to get our children involved.
The sharing and subsistence isn't just about the catch or the harvest. It's about knowledge and conservation. And at the end of all of it, conserving the resource is actually about conserving each other. If there is one thing the COVID pandemic is teaching us, it's that we need each other. We want connection.
You know, we were at Southside bowhead whale hunting, and we worked on the bowhead whale for 3 days, 4 days. None of us slept. You know, we took turns as a crew. So I came home with a sled full of monk duck. I mean, that's a lot. And my uncle, and then he came in a few minutes later, and all I see is your bag, your hunting bag. And he goes, yeah, that's my share. He gave half of it to Gamble community, half it to us and the Sivunga community. And he just, and that's where he came home with a small one. I was really impressed with that.
I can't recall like the first time or whatever, but I just remember doing that all the time. No matter what we'd get, we'd go and make sure that those people that we knew weren't able to provide for themselves, to make sure that they, you know, had some game. It's nice to see that trend continuing with, you know, the next generations.
How can people living in cities practice subsistence? This was the question that bridges the gap from an ancient way to a modern society. It was a new question and required a loosening of the definitions.
If we could make the scope a little broader, urban gardens are a huge thing, you know, community gardens are a big thing. And being with Parks and Recs, I'm learning that in a lot of cities, New York City took an old subway platform and has made it into a greenway community garden. And I'm finding that more communities are doing that.
They just have to live it. I mean, even just say it's Arizona. There's stuff to do down there. You know, there's fishing, there's hunting, there's gathering. But it's until you actually get out and do it, it's hard to explain that to somebody.
And since The Greatest Generation, I believe we've tried to make it easier for our kids than we had it. And that's part of that consumption concept, because, well, heck, we don't have to wait till Christmas to buy you a toy. We're at the store right now, and I have $20 in my pocket. I've personally became aware of the ills I think it has, and I've just become much more, no, I don't need that. And I'm trying to declutter my life from that, but it's an addiction of sorts, I suppose.
To me, do they want the connection? But I'm not trying to judge anybody else, but you know, there are people that really do want to learn, really want to experience stuff like that. One person in my life had told me in our language, Nikovnake, Nikovnakutin, stand up. Of all of the teachings that was taught to you, it's your turn.
Do we want the connection? If subsistence goes into our relationship to each other and our stewardship over the planet, then there are lots of ways we can all practice the spirit of subsistence. Paper or plastic? Do we know our neighbors or our kids? Respect, sharing, connection, gratitude, the great books condensed down to these. During quarantine, I've seen more families in my neighborhood taking open-air walks this week than in the previous year combined. Rivers are clearing so you can see the fish. There is hope. Moving forward, do we want the connection isn't a rhetorical question. The answer to that question is the answer to how this story can find a new beginning.
Stand up. It's your turn. You have to stand up and do it yourself now. Of all of the teachings that was taught to you, it's your turn.
I love going out in the country, and one afternoon I kept waving at this person up on the hill at Teller. Kept waving, that person would wave at me, and I'd wave at them and collect some more. And as that person got closer, I realized it was a grizzly bear swatting mosquitoes. It wasn't waving at me, it was swatting at mosquitoes, and so I ran home.